We had the honor and privilege of sitting down today with Daphne Kuhn, a legend in the South African and international theater community. Daphne is founder of Theater on the Square in Sandton and has had an illustrious career that started off on the stage as a young actress in Pretoria and has led her to the Theater on the Square, which has put on well over 3,000 productions since it was founded in 1994. We chat about the value of theater and why it is so important to a community and a country, the future of the theater, how they survived COVID, and what they need from the community that they serve. Daphne also talks about the incredible productions that are coming up in the year ahead, and we also touch on some lovely memories and light-hearted moments. If you're a lover of the theater, if you have thought about getting involved in the theater, this one is for you. Welcome to Coffee and Conversations with Champions, the theatrical edition. There we are. Fabulous. So we've just started recording, so I'd like to say welcome to the podcast, Daphne Kuhn. It's wonderful to have you on. We appreciate you making your time. And we also appreciate the fantastic location that you chose to speak to us in, which is your theater on the square.
Really, this is such an honor for me to talk to you today. And certainly it's on home ground for me here at the Theatre on the Square. So lovely to chat to you. I'm sure we've got lots to discuss.
We absolutely do. So if we could start off, could you give us a brief background? Who is Daphne?
Well, I always loved the theatre, and as a little girl I participated in children's theatre plays in Pretoria, where my mother was on the committee of the Pretoria Children's Theatre, and my siblings and I participated in a lot of children's shows. And at school, of course, I also took part in Shakespeare plays, and it was during the production of a play of A Midsummer Night's Dream when I was cast as Titania that I realised that this was my passion. It was a long, passionate affair with the theatre. And after I finished school, I had to toss up between studying officially at university.
It appears we've lost Daphne, ladies and gentlemen.
Poor Daniels. Even though I sat in Afrikaans, I could act and write in English. So I've had the benefit of that, and of course later.
Of the studio. So we lost you there for a moment.
Okay. Oh. Should Can I start hear? Again?
We had you basically up to Midsummer's Night Dream.
Okay. That was the beginning of a long and passionate affair with theatre. And I had to choose between making music a career or drama, theatre, because right. I'd been learning music and the piano. I went very far with my exams in Estedfords, and I achieved my ATCL piano teacher's exam. But I decided I loved theatre so much. It was it wasn't so lonesome. It's wonderful to work together as a team, and I pursued that at university in Pretoria. I studied in Afrikaans under Anna Netling-Poole and Niels Hansen. I was able to write in English and perform in both Afrikaans and English, and which it stayed me in. It was good for me at the time, and soon after I left university, I finished a BA honours and a master's degree. I joined, in addition to acting in film and stage, I joined SABC television service from its inception, and worked under Colin Duplessis and Mike Leeson-Smith from the BBC. So I've had a nice background of being on stage, producing, acting, directing, and only later I made my career as a producer, which involved obviously selecting, assembling the cast, selecting plays, buying the rights, working out the budgets, being totally involved in marketing, publicity, and everything else that goes with creating a theatre. And then, when was it? It was in 1994.
Right, yes.
New Democracy. I started a new theatre in Rosebank. It's 30 years ago, which I can't believe the time has gone so fast. 30 years ago, I started my first little theatre as an independent producer in Rosebank for a few years, and it was beautiful and sweet. We did a number of productions. And then in 1997, I opened Theatre on the Square here in Sandton on the Nelson Mandela Square. It was previously called Sandton Square. And it has grown, you know, really gone from strength to strength. I've worked with the most wonderful people, passionate about their art. I really believe I've uplifted the community in so many ways. I've given, you know, generated work opportunities for thousands in our industry. And I've actually produced about 3,000 plays, local and international comedies, musicals, whatever, local and international plays, and lots of concerts. So they've been so much happening in this little cultural hub in a suburb where I love to bring people, to uplift them. And it's been a very rewarding journey, a very hard journey from a financial point of view, but a very uplifting journey. And for a number of years, I had various insurance companies lending their name because they recognized our tireless work here at the Theatre on the Square. And I have had sponsorship over the years, but for the last 3 years, and certainly before COVID, I've had to go it and do it on my own completely. So day and night, it's a long, hard day and night process of planning and budgeting and rehearsing and making it all happen for everybody and creating lovely work opportunities, creating wonderful plays and producing one after the other every single day. So I work actually day and night, and I've managed somehow to keep afloat in this difficult environment. And it's been a wonderful journey all the way.
It must have been incredibly challenging over the last few years, and I'd like to chat to you about that as well, because I think that's vital to your role as a leader for your own business and within the theatre community. What I wanted to ask first, though, was what was the idea, what was the event or something that started you to move from being on the stage to being in the production role, in the marketing role? What sort of caused you to move from the stage on?
Well, to be quite honest, it was my own personal life. I had a baby. I've got two children. I'm now a granny of four grandchildren. But I was not able to work every night. And that's when I started looking for a new pathway in my career. And I chose to be a theatre producer, which started in Rosebank. I also had done some course in public relations and marketing, and that is the essence of what it's all about. You can have a brilliant production, but if it's not marketed or publicized well, it won't be a success. And I have no business background, but my husband sort of helped me on that route. And, you know, obviously have done it all myself, but I changed to be more practical and have a theatre. And in the end, I think I work doubly hard. I work in the day and the night now. For those first few years, you know, I managed.
Right. I was going to say, it's you're taking on such such a big role that you end up with less time because of all the demands on you. So what was
the demands are great.
Yeah, absolutely. And what was the decision sort of to continue working to build the theater rather than perhaps stay at home and just look after the kids? Because it's a big commitment and there's passion behind it.
Yes. Lots of passion, and also passion for my family, which I've balanced, I hope.
Yes.
And it's been hard, but it's you know, one can manage. And it's hard for a woman as well. And I should mention that my passion has actually always been to entertain and educate the community, especially about changing democracy in 1994, to educate spiritually and culturally, to expand people's minds through the beautiful medium of theatre and music for all, and to perpetuate for audiences the joy of live performance. And that's when I, you know, that was really what got me going and got my creative juices going. And, you know, there are times, the first theatre was in Rosebank. And at that point in 1994, people were obviously bemoaning the demise of theatre. And then, of course, later I established the theatre in Sandton. But, you know, I'm sure you will agree with me and your listeners will agree too. Can you imagine a world without music, without theatre, without film, without dance, without musicals, without art and thought-provoking plays and films? And Laurence Olivier once wrote, a country that loves its theatre is a healthy country. It's part of our lives and part of our cultural tapestry for generations to come. It's a nation's storyboard, the very measure of a civilized society. And of course, that's what my intention is.
Absolutely.
To have a beautiful hub that is cultured and civilized and accessible and safe and somewhere that one can be entertained and educated at the same time. So that was basically, you know, what got me going so many years ago.
And what keeps you
and
going?
Of course, and it keeps me going. It is. I'm always thrilled because I work with such interesting people, creative people. And there's always something new. Every few weeks, a new play, a new interpretation of the play, new people, new audiences, always looking for different audiences, a lovely mix of audiences. And, you know, we present beautiful Eurocentric plays and African plays and work with all the top playwrights in this country and musicians as well. Every Friday we have a classical lunch hour concert, every single Friday for decades now, and on Sundays jazz concerts and comedy, and there's always such a beautiful variety. I just want Theatre on the Square to be the home of everyone, where they feel comfortable and safe and a place where they can enjoy life, because I think culture is so important. It's so diminished, you know, our governments sadly don't really support our art enough. And I've had to, you know, try and create and keep the theatre alive by looking to our audiences and doing it without any form of sponsorship. Right. And obviously it was dreadful during the 2 years of COVID. We were closed. And I thought to open would be impossible. It seemed insurmountable. And especially I was continuing to keep my resident staff alive as well. And everybody was paid during that period. Right. I decided, because I didn't have any form of governmental or local provincial sponsorship or any form of help whatsoever, I launched a fundraising drive and a crowdfunding drive. And I raised quite a lot of money, which kept us going and allowed us to open a few years later. And, you know, we started off slowly, spacing people. We were only allowed to have 50% capacity audiences. And it has grown and developed. And we present plays that reflect our community and all the problems that we have in this community worldwide. You know, it's so important that we keep this theatre alive. And it actually has gone from strength to strength, and thankfully so, with the support of the community. And the Jewish community have been very supportive, of course. I often give a talk on the Jewish contribution to theatre and entertainment in South Africa. I've done this on numerous occasions, and there's so many people, because we're speaking on a Jewish radio station. Mm-hmm. You know, it has, you know, it's been a place where people feel at home. We've presented plays on numerous Jewish themes, of course, everything else as well. But on Jewish themes, we've had Jewish fundraisers, we have concerts, and, you know, it's wonderful for the community to come to theatre on the way. Yeah.
And I think what makes theatre... Yeah, absolutely. Going to the theatre is an event. And it's something that is still special, and it's something that one looks forward to, hopefully dresses up a little bit for. And you make that part of a way of treating yourself, educating yourself, giving a little bit of time to yourself, which is so vital.
Absolutely. It is a special time, and it should be held with the same regard, the high regard, as anything else. You know, sport is very important, of course, but arts and culture are essential in our lives. And it is a special place and a special time for everybody to come and relax. And you to COVID, of course, not only the challenge of coming and the enjoyment of coming to a theatre production, but it's been a healing process for so many people. It's very important
But from, if we go back to your early career on the stage, what role have you seen theatre play in the evolution of South Africa, moving from an apartheid state, moving from that struggle, moving from that incredible oppression? There was no freedom of speech, there was no freedom of voice, but there was always theatre and helping the country evolve into a democracy.
You know, I worked for the Market Theatre before I started my own theatre, prior to 1994, and I was so influenced by the role it played and how important it was, because during the war, the years of apartheid, from about 1948 to 1994, the theatre played a very significant role in reflecting and critiquing the racial segregation and oppression imposed by the apartheid government. And, you know, there were so many plays that were known as protest theatre plays. There was censorship. There was very little community in black theatre, of course, that started developing.
And I think back then there was Serafina, which was a huge talking point.
So much else written by Al Fugard and later Paul Slavolepsy and so many others whom I worked with. And I believe that in my new theatre after 1994, that the theatre should also be a voice of the people in reflecting, you know, situations. And even today, like last year, we did a lovely new play by local South Africans, Home Affairs. It reflected not the past only in apartheid and all the plays we've done by Fugard and Ackerman and Homan and so many others, Slavolepsy, but a new voice reflecting our critique of the current government. And although I'm a totally pro South African in every possible way, I adore this country and I adore Israel as well. But we have to criticize from time to time, and it is so important to do it through the medium of theatre. It can be done in a very gentle way, but it at least educates people and provokes people and challenges people at the same time. And I think during those apartheid years and then at the Market Theatre, things made, you know, people's minds were opened up to what was actually happening, and it's so important to perpetuate that, that role and that ideal.
And as you said earlier, it's an indicator, quoting Sir Laurence Olivier, it's an indicator of the health of our society, of the health of our community.
Absolutely. With the commitment. And isn't so important, that commitment. Another quote that I always, quote, is by Oscar Wilde, who long ago wrote, "The theatre is the greatest of all art forms. It's the most immediate way in which an actor can share with an audience the essence of what it is to be a human being." And I think that's what theatre is also all about. It's about the human condition, understanding other people's perspectives, understanding our various cultural groups, understanding politics and how, you know, and the variations of thought and how we look at our lives, both here in South Africa and elsewhere. And it's so important that that is reflected through our art.
And the beauty of the theatre is there's no separation of screen. You know, you can watch a movie in a theatre, you can watch it on your television or on your mobile, but in I think there's a deeper connection to the people on stage and the audience than in any other form.
That is absolutely right. You know, when it was COVID, a lot of our theatre and entertainment practitioners pivoted and started creating content digitally, which was excellent. And of course, we watched every night Netflix and everything else and on our screens, which was absolutely wonderful. But then when we came back to the normal life again and we were able to go to live entertainment, what a difference it makes. We react as a heartbeat, as one when we're in a theatre. It's so that connectivity between audience and those on stage is so important. And it's very significant indeed.
What is that like, transitioning from the stage onto an electronic format and then back for the artists? Because how much of what they do is that connection with the audience, the emotions, the feeling, the sense?
You know, they can't feel that response. Yes. And that is the element that keeps theatre alive, that live element, the immediacy of it all. And audiences, as I say, they react as one when you're in an audience to whatever's on. So whether it's music or a deep play that has an underlying meaning, you act as one, you react as one. And it's such a wonderful experience to be in a live auditorium.
Absolutely. For me, my favorite thing, and I was chatting to Harry Sideropoulos about this when we spoke last week, and saying for me, my favorite thing is the intermission, because I love you leave the theater, you come out and you can hear everybody talking and commenting and sharing what they're feeling and what they're getting. And that's such an amazing buzz to be part of that, to be amongst all of those people. And then the bell goes and you go back in. It's the most wonderful experience.
It's a wonderful experience. That's the joy, just to see or hear the reaction of the audience, the ovation at the end, the standing ovation. You know, at the moment, we've got a fabulous show on with a wonderful young talent called Daniel Anderson. It's called Mad About the Boys. It looks at the stories and lives of those icons of yesteryear, Noel Coward, Ivor Novello, and Cole Porter. And this wonderful actor and singer puts it all together in this beautiful show accompanied by Paul Ferreira on the piano. And Daniel Anderson is an absolute star. And I can't tell you the joy I get alone, just me, just watching the audience react with such happiness and joy. And as they come out of the theater, and they, as you say, there's a buzz. Yes. On Saturday night, there was a wonderful feeling, excitement of all being together, and a praise for the performers and joy from what the music and the stories brought to the audience. It's the most wonderful experience. Nothing like live theatre.
Absolutely nothing like live theatre. In your experience, what do you feel South Africa has brought to the world in terms of theatre, productions, artists, and so on?
You know, that's a hard question, because South Africa's brought a huge amount to the world, because we recognize our various cultural elements, or the people, the cultural diversity, and we respect that. And, you know, so many of our wonderful musicians have really reached heights all over the world. Think of Johnny Clegg, for example, in music, some of our wonderful opera singers, our artists themselves, not just reflecting South Africa, but the talents that have come out of this country, because certainly after 1994, the talent and the opportunities are immense. And some, not everybody, but so many artists have gone from strength to strength, have performed at festivals all over the world, and then are discovered and are, you know, have been seen on the big stages of New York, Broadway, and of course in the West End. Absolutely. They have, you know, there has been a lot of wonderful work, and certainly in film as well, but they've brought a lot to the world, and recognition of the diversity of South Africa and the different cultural groups and how we think and feel and perform. It's been very exciting indeed.
Absolutely. Can you tell us a little bit about the future? What are you planning? What do you have coming up for the theatre? What do people have to look forward to?
Well, I was delighted because they had the Fleurde Cup Awards in Cape Town the night before last, and the best actor was chosen as for his role, and he wrote a lovely new South African play called King George, and Brent Palmer won the Fleurde Cup. So that's coming up
Fantastic.
To us in April. Our lunch hour concert will be performed by the African Renaissance Ensemble. The maestro is Adam Golding, and we'll also feature the lovely Lee Noodleman from our community. There's so many lovely concerts coming up. We finish Mad About the Boys this week with Daniel Anderson. And then we open next week with another local play called Ill with Sophie Jones. And then at the same time, during the day, we'll be having more children's theatre with puppets, a delightful play called The Baker and the Little Rat, and then a new play called Your Perfect Life, written and performed by Erica Breitenbach-Marie and Farron Wheeler, directed by Sue Deepaveen, who starred in one of her own shows here last year. And then, of course, it's King George. And then we're bringing back some of our very favourite comedians. Nick Rabinowitz will be back in July. Sculptor Soda. Sculpt Besode Notes has already sold tons of tickets already, and he's only coming back at the end of June. Siv Ngesi. We hope to bring back John Cello, Marker, and Kuba. I don't know if you remember him last year in the John Carney play, Nothing But the Truth. There's just so much. I try to present a real variety to appeal to everyone on different levels, to bring the schools in, to educate them. We have Q&As afterwards. We do set works, we do children's theatre, we do a bit of everything. I work with some of the drama teachers, like Vicky Friedman's Fame Academy, and we present their workshops and showcases also every term. There's a lot happening all the time in music and in drama. And this last year, we also presented Fiona Ramsey and Graham Hopkins in Hansard, and so it goes on. All our top actors and directors, Alan Swerdlow, directing so many of our shows with Sharon Spiegel and Laurie Strauss. And it's just very exciting all the time. There's a lovely wealth of talent. And last weekend, we had Ihashi Elim Shloppy, the famous icon in Zulu music, presenting an enormous concert for a few days. It was absolutely packed. So as you can see, there's huge variety to appeal to everybody. I have a wonderful team. I believe I've tried to lead them and train them in the way that I've been trained. And I have also developed my business skills. I've got a lovely team, a marketing team, Mika Dostavitsosvana and Bronwyn Hershovitz on our team. And so we plan well ahead, a year ahead for all our shows. Fantastic. Obviously, we hope that some go overseas again. And there's some are planned already.
Okay, fantastic. And I think your website is also wonderful. It's interactive. It's easy to see what's coming up. What is the best way for people to book and to see sort of what's coming up? Onto the website or...
Nick, they can go onto the website, they can select the plan, it links to CompuTicket. So CompuTicket is our booking service, and you can go directly to CompuTicket, or quite simply call the theatre. I always give all the telephone numbers, and we can do telephonic bookings, which makes it very easy for all.
Fantastic. We'll put those numbers up in the links below as well.
That would be great. Thank you. Awesome. We need everybody. I must mention that I'm going to go all out again to do a fundraising drive. We have a wonderful fundraising strategy. We're looking for a naming rights sponsor. We're looking for sponsors for our music concerts or for individual plays. And if anybody's interested, I'd be so delighted to speak to them. They can call me on the number that you have.
Right. And it's so important because I think I was going to say the protection, and I think it does come down, the protection of theatre is a responsibility of everyone who wants to maintain a kind and educated and I suppose a society that's civil to one another, because it gives us the opportunity to express what we need to say in ways perhaps that that are non-violent, that are non-aggressive, that can still provoke emotion and allow us to develop a deeper understanding of one another and give us an opportunity to connect in ways we may not have been able to. So it's a very, very firm responsibility for everyone, either to attend, to sponsor, to support.
Thank you, Nick. I think you've really put it in a nutshell. It's all about connectivity and so important for us all to grow and develop in South Africa and work together as a happy community. It's so important. And thank you so much for this interview. It's been lovely to talk to you.
It's been absolutely wonderful. Daphne, thank you so much for your time. And thank you for what you've shared with us and the passion. I'm going to end the recording now and then I'll say goodbye to you.